Hello friends, in this tutorial, second tutorial, we are going to talk about the following topics. So first we will be talking about Python programming language, then Python libraries which are important for data science, and we will be using them, then Python installation, and we will be talking about arithmetic operations, some basic arithmetic operations using Python. Strings, comments, then functions and their types, and at the end we'll be talking about exceptions. Okay, let's start. The first topic is here, Python programming language. Now before Python programming language, we have to know what is programming language and what is the usage of these programming languages here. So any programming languages, if we consider, they are used to communicate with machines and tell them what to do. So using programming languages like C, C++, Java, any of these programming languages, it helps the programmers to write their programs and tell the machines what they want. So Python is also a programming language, so it is used for communicating with machines, and we will be doing our programming using this Python programming language. So why we are using Python programming language? So many reasons are there. The reasons are listed below. I will be talking about them. So what is Python? Python is a programming language, and it is a popular programming language. It is a simple programming language, and this programming language is not only a programming language, but it is also a scripting language. Programming language Python has the following features. The first feature here is it is simple. It is a simple programming language. It has simple syntax. It is not like C, C++, Java to write like main functions, then brackets. It is so much sensitive, those things. So it is not that much sensitive. We don't have brackets, main functions, all these things, stuffs. So the second one, it is called easy language. So that is the reason it is called easy learning. It is easy to learn. It is cross-platform, means you can download and install in any platform, like maybe Windows, maybe Mac operating system, Linux operating system. So you can use them anywhere. The next one is it is open source and free of cost. Large standard libraries it has. It is supporting so many standard libraries. That is the reasons people are using this Python programming language nowadays. It is supporting so many advanced features. So these are all the features or characteristics of Python programming language, which is supporting both programming language, scripting language, and it is also object-oriented programming language. It is simple and it is easy to learn. These are the reasons people are using Python programming language in data science, for data analysis. Even if the students or those people which they don't have knowledge of programming, like maybe C, C++ of these things, they can use programming language, sorry, Python programming language for their data analysis. No need of those much knowledge to have. But if you have it, so it will be so much simple and easy for you. Okay, next C. Some important libraries which are important so much for data science, and it is supported by Python. So these libraries we'll be talking about one by one here. First, these libraries are divided into two types. Okay, some libraries are called for use for data manipulation, and some libraries are there, they are used for data visualization. So for data manipulation, we will be using these libraries, which are called NumPy, SciPy, Pandas, scikit-learn. So let's see one by one what is NumPy. So NumPy is a library which is supported by Python programming language. So this library supports many mathematical and statistical operations, and it has so many predefined functions in it, which helps a lot the one who is using them. For data analysis, it is supporting multi-dimensional arrays, matrices, and it has so many functions for them for manipulation, etc. The second one is SciPy. SciPy is the same as NumPy. It is supporting larger number of algorithms, linear algebra, differential equations, optimizations, and statistics. It is built on NumPy. The next one is Pandas. This Pandas is used to import and manipulate tabular form data. So the data which is in the form of tables means rows and columns. If you are using them in our analysis, so we will be using the time Pandas library, and it is supporting so many functions, and it has so many predefined functions, and one by one these functions will be used there for reshaping, merging, sorting, slicing, aggregations, etc. Next we have scikit-learn. The scikit-learn library, which is supported by Python, it is used in machine learning algorithms, for example for classification, regression, clustering, model validation, etc. So many functions, predefined functions are written here. We can import this and use the functions. The second important library here is used for data visualization. So for data visualizations we have two main libraries here. One is called matplotlib and another one is called seaborn. So matplotlib is a 2D plotting library. It is supporting like line plots, scatter plots, bar charts, histograms, pie charts, etc. And if we come to the second library, which is called seaborn, it is also used for data visualization, but it is supporting attractive statistical graphs. This is 2D, but this one is supporting 3D, and so attractive statistical graphics are there and we can use it. The next one, let's see how to install this Python programming language. So for installation of Python programming language, we have to refer this website, so www.python.org. If you go there, you can download and install the Python. But I recommend you, instead of only installing Python, it is better to install Anaconda. So by installing Anaconda, it is supporting so many libraries and also it has Python in it. So let's see. Okay, later on we will be talking about these operations like Python arithmetics, basic, some basic operations on Python like addition, subtraction, multiplication. We will be talking about string and functions, exceptions. These things I will be showing you practically here. Let's see here. If you go to python.org here, this website, this is the Python website. Here you can come and if you scroll down here you find downloads. From downloads you can download the Python here, and it is the latest version here. Now it is 3.82. this is the latest version. You can download and install it if you want only Python. But instead of only downloading Python and installing it, it is better to go to this website which is called Anaconda. In Anaconda, if you are installing, it has Python and also so many other important libraries which are supported by this. See, there are the libraries here, you can use them. And see, we talked about like NumPy, scikit-learn, Pandas, matplot, and so many other libraries. It has Jupyter for like graphically if you are working. So these are all the libraries supported by Anaconda. You can download them manually or by installing the Anaconda. So many of them will be installed automatically along with installation. So here if you scroll down and come to the last part of the website, here you have Anaconda installers. If you're using Windows, if you're using Mac operating system, Linux operating system, you can download any version here. Like these are the previous versions, Python 2.7, but the latest version is 3.7. you can download this one. I'm using Windows operating system, so I have downloaded this one and installed this one in my PC. So after installation, if you go to like here, just a folder will be created for you. Yeah, like this here, Anaconda. And here we have Anaconda Navigator. If you open this Anaconda Navigator, you will be getting a page like, okay, It is taking some time. Okay, this page you will be seeing. Here we have Jupyter Notebook. You can click on Jupyter Notebook. So launch on this. Okay. Taking some time. Yeah, this will be the page here. You can go to here like upload if you want to upload some files, data sets, etc. From here you can download and upload the files here. If you want to create a new file, Python file, you go to here like by clicking this, a new Jupyter notebook will be open like this. You can write your code here like I'm writing a simple code. Hello world, for example. If I'm executing, just by pressing shift plus enter, you can execute and run the program. So as you are observing here, no need of main function, brackets, those things are not there like C++, Java. Only you can write your code and it will be executed. From here also you can run it, or by clicking like shift plus enter, that also will be executing. Since I have already opened here, I'm closing this. Okay, here I come to my own page. So let's see, as I said here, we will talking about some basic Python arithmetic operations, and let's see how we can calculate and evaluate those things. So first I want to accept two numbers from the keyboards here, the basic operations. So first number will be stored in X, the second value will be stored in Y, and after that I'm going to add these two numbers. But one thing you have to remember, if you are accepting anything from the keyboard, that will be considered as a string. So string cannot be added, it will be okay concatenated. That is why I have done here typecasting. I mean, first the first value of X is converted to integer, the second value which is stored in Y, that is converted to integer. So both now X and Y are integers, then I can add them. And the result I can see as integer. So see, the first number is 2 and the second number is 3, the result is 5. If I'm not using these integers here, that will be concatenated and the result will be displayed as 23, which is concatenated, means 2 in 3, like this, 2 in 3, it will be concatenated. That is why I have used here typecasting. Let's see arithmetic operations here, basic like addition, subtraction, multiplication. So for addition we are using plus sign for adding the numbers, multiplication this minus sign, store for multiplication, and this one forward slash for division. But here we have some other symbols which are called double forward slash. So this double forward slash is used also for division, but integer division. Integer division means it is not considering the floating point, that portion will be dropped. So if you want to find the remainder, this sign is used, percentage, if you want to raise a number into some power, so we are using this this sign, double store. Let's see here the example. Okay, the first number is stored integer, it is in X, the second number is also integer, it is stored in Y. So I have already two numbers, X and Y. Now I want to sum them, this sign is used if you're using this one, and for multiplication store is used, and for division this symbol, and integer division this. Okay, let me execute this part and we'll be getting the result as this one. So sum is 14, 6, 40, 2.5 in 2. So if you're using the symbol, it will be showing you this part also, floating point or decimal part also. But if you are using double forward slash, this one, it is used for integer division, and it will drop the floating point values. So remainder is 2, and this one is used for power. I have raised, okay, the value of x is 10. If it is raised to the power of 4, it becomes 10,000. Okay, let's see what is string. String is a group of characters, or we can say string is a sequence of characters which are written within single quotation or double quotation. No problem here in Python. But if you remember in C++ programming, there for string we are using double quotation, and for single character we are using single quotation. But here in Python, no matter, you can use single quotation or double quotation, both are used for indicating the string. Example is given here, see. Okay, h is equal to, this is my variable and I am storing in it hello. W is equal to word, and I am storing in that word. So this word is written within double quotation, and hello is written within single quotation. Both are considered as string, and here I am printing them. So the first value hello, then tab, two tabs I have put here, and then W, which is nothing but word. If you want a single tab, so you remove forward, so backslash t, only one backslash t is for one tab. So see here again, I'm printing hello world in single quotation, hello world in double quotation. Let's see the result. So hello, the first variable is printed, then concatenated with that. What is concatenated here? A tab. So if I want two tabs, so again slash t I put, then see this much space is given here. Then hello world, this one is printed. Again, hello world, data science, this one is print. Now let's see what is comment. Comment is nothing but descriptions of different parts of your program. For example, if you want to describe your program, the variables, the functions, the classes, maybe you are giving information about the programmer, different things you are explaining, and that is called comments. And these comments are not read by the compiler or interpreter, it is ignored there. It is just for our reference or user reference. It is extra information given about the program. As other programming languages, here Python is also supporting comments, and we have two types of comments. The first type is called single line comment, and it will be indicating using this one hash symbol. If we have multi-line comments, and for that we are using this triple quotation. Single line comments, this one slash hash symbol is used, and you write your comment here. But if it is exceeding from one line to the second line, third line, it is better to use multi-line comments like this, and that will be used within triple quotations. Okay, let's talk about the functions. So function, what is function? Function is a piece of code which is used to perform a specific task. Like, this is the facility for us. Once we are writing a function that can be used multiple times, a function which is written, it can be used any number of times, anywhere we can call them and use them. So that is the reasons we are creating the functions, and they are used the most. So different types of functions we have. The first type is called built-in functions. In built-in functions, again, we have two types, arithmetic functions, and we have string functions. In arithmetic functions, example, we have like sum, or we have maximum, minimum, sine, cosine, tangent, and we have round function. They are called arithmetic functions. If you go to string functions, which are used for group of characters, so for example, if I want to convert a string into uppercase, I will be using this function upper, lowercase for lowercase if you want to. So this function is used replacing something in a string or capitalizing the first letter. So we'll be using this function. So many other predefined functions are there. As an example, I have listed few here. And then we have the second type of functions, that is called user-defined function. So the user-defined functions, the name itself indicates user-defined, means we are defining our own functions. They are not predefined, they are not already stored there in the library, they are the functions what we are writing, so they are called user-defined functions. For example, you can give any name for your function. For example, I have used here my function, but this one is predefined function. You have to use the same one, sum, then it will perform some operation. Otherwise, if you're using someone, so that someone is not working, or if you're using someone, that will be your own function, you have to define it. But if you're using some, this is a predefined function. And this one, you can write your other name, whatever you want. So in Python, we have some other things called anonymous functions that also can be used. And these are the functions, they are called anonymous because they have no name. But they can have any number of arguments, but there is no name for them. Let's see practically how they are. So arithmetic functions, if you consider an array or list of values here, you can find the sum, you can find the maximum, the minimum, the length, and you can round a number. As you see here, I said, okay, you round it up to 3 decimal values. It will drop this one and it will be considered only this part. You can put here 2, 3 or 0, any numbers you can put. I have put 3, so it will be rounding up to 3. See here? Okay, the sum is this much. Okay, maximum, minimum, and the length is shown here that much. How many, okay, values are there, 7 values are there. These are called predefined functions and they are arithmetic functions. If you go to the string functions, here, they are the string functions. First, I have defined here a string, like data science, and it is stored in a variable called str. I'm converting that str to uppercase and then lowercase and then capitalize the first letter. And then if I want to count the number of a in this string, so count is used. Or for example, if you want to count any number of words, any word in a string, so you will be using count there. If you want to check whether the string is in uppercase, so you use this boolean function which is called isUpper. It is returning either true or false. If it is really in uppercase, it will be returning true, otherwise false. So it is converted to uppercase, lowercase, capitalized, and it says okay, 2 means this A is repeated twice. So here it is says it is false, means it is not in uppercase, all the letters. Let's go to the user-defined functions and see what they are. User-defined functions, we are defining our own function. So the name of function, I've written here greeting. You can give any name, valid name, then open the parentheses and close the parentheses. And then you put colon. This one is important. Colon you have to put in here. You have to remember the indentation. This much space is required. If you remove the space, it is giving you the error. Otherwise, you have to type here and press enter. It is taking automatically and showing you this much indentation is required. So the keyword def is used for creating your own function. Def. This is a predefined keyword def. So I've used keyword def and I created my function. In here I'm calling my function and let's see what is the result. It is showing me hello friends. Okay, the second function I'm defining here, it is called add. And this add function, okay, opposite to this, it has two arguments, x and y, with default values. X is equal to 0, y is equal to 0. It means if I'm not passing values to this function add, it will be considered as x as 0 and y as 0 and returning the sum also as 0. But here when I'm calling my function add, I'm passing two values, x is equal to 2, y is equal to 3, so those two numbers will be added and the result will be printed in front of the string total and it is equal to 5. But if I'm removing these two values, now what will happen? The function requires two values but I'm passing nothing, so these default values will be considered. X is considered as 0, y is considered as 0, so the result is also 0. But if I'm passing only one value, that one value will come to x, the y is considered as 0 and the result is equal to 12, because 12 plus 0 is 12, but let it be 2 and 3, and the result is 5. Okay, the next function here, anonymous function. I have created a function with no name. It has no name. That is why it's called anonymous function, and it is done by using a keyword called lambda in Python. See, I am passing a value, but this value is passed to something which has no name. Simply, I have created an anonymous function which is incrementing the value by 10. So if I'm passing 1, this 1 will be incremented by 10, and that will be 11. But what is the name of your function? Function has no name, only the variable is there. So here again I'm passing 3 variables. You can pass any number of arguments can have the anonymous functions. Here it has only 1, and here it has 3, but here it is multiplying the two numbers and adding it with the third number, and the result will be displayed as this: 11 and 14. The function which has no name is called anonymous function, and it is used by the keyword of lambda. Any number of arguments it can have. Okay, let's see exceptions. The last topic was exception. So what is exception? Exception, if you remember, you have studied in C, C++, and other programming languages. Exceptions are called the wrongs, or they are called the conditions, or something that leads your program to inaccurate result. So the program will be run, but it will be not giving you the proper output. So the output will be not correct. So that is called exception. That should be handled. But in other languages, we were using try and catch. Here we are using try and except. So I'm taking two numbers, x is equal to 10 and y is equal to 0. And here, x divided by y means 10 divided by 0, that is an exception. This will cause a problem. So it has to be handled. If it is not handled, it will cause the problem. So let it be first like 4. Now x is equal to 10, y is equal to 4. It will be displaying me the quotient, because there is no problem, and we'll be getting the result here. It is 2.5. But what happens if I remove this input 0? But this time it is not executing this part, because it is exception. The number cannot be divided by 0, and it will drop an exception. An exception is called zero division error is there. So this we will be catching, and we will be handling it here. Okay, see, it is not dividing, it is not showing us the quotient, but dropping an exception and says the number cannot be divided by 0. So these were the topics we discussed in today's tutorial. I hope you understood these things.